Well, good morning and welcome. This is 10 years hence. My name is James O'Rourke. I'm a professor of management and director of the Fanning Center for Business Communication. I'll be your instructor and host for this lecture series. Thank you for being here. We've arranged a series of 7 lectures for you that I think you'll find interesting and exciting. Our aim is to engage in some structured speculation about the future, specifically the decade just ahead and the world we're likely to inhabit 10 years from now. While life 100 years from now will be interesting, I think it's safe to say very few in this room will actually be there. I think 10 years from now, the odds are good that most of us will be there, and I think if we begin thinking now about those issues and intervention strategies, that we'll have a reasonable opportunity to construct a future for ourselves that we each can live with. So let's begin the series now with our first session. Professor Frank Incropera received his Bachelor of Science degree from the Massachusetts Institute of Technology and his MS and PhD from Stanford University, all in mechanical engineering. Except for research leaves spent at NASA Ames, UC Berkeley, and the Technical University of Munich, he was with Purdue University from 1966 to 1998. He was promoted to professor in 1973 and was head of the School of Mechanical Engineering from 89 to 98. From 1998 to 2006, Frank served as the Matthew H. McCloskey Dean of Engineering at the University of Notre Dame. Professor Incropera has received numerous awards for teaching and contributions to engineering education, along with the Worcester Reed Warner Medal from the American Society of Mechanical Engineers in 1995. In 96, he was elected to the U.S. National Academy of Engineering. Most recently, he was named by the Institute for Scientific Information as one of the 100 most frequently cited engineering researchers in the world. Professor Incropera has a long-standing interest in basic energy sciences and has authored or co-authored 15 books and more than 200 journal articles in this field. In recent years, his work has focused on technology and policy issues associated with the transition to a sustainable energy future. He is the author of the 2016 book, Climate Change, A Wicked Problem. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Professor Frank Incropera.
Thank you, James, and thank you all for coming. I know that this series is forward-looking. It's about the future. But I'd like to begin by going through some history, starting in the Dark Ages when I was an undergraduate student. At that time, a number of courses that I took, a senior thesis that I did, really stimulated my interest in energy sciences and energy applications. And these two areas have really been focal points of my teaching and research throughout my career. But in 1973, there was an event that, in many respects, was for me an epiphany. And that event had to do with what's called the October War. And as a consequence of that war, or during the progress of that war, the U.S. chose to support one of the participants by rearming it, and in doing so, prevented that participant from being overwhelmed. That action by the U.S. prompted a response by nations, particularly nations associated with OPEC, the Organization for Petroleum Exports, stimulated nations within that group to impose an embargo on oil shipments to the U.S. Of course, oil is a global commodity. Embargoes don't work, at least without military action. And so, realizing that, these nations then decided what they would do in the way of punishment was to reduce the amount of oil production, and they did so by several million barrels of oil per day. Now, that did have an impact. For a period of about 5 or 6 months, it had a significant economic impact on developed nations of the West and Japan, the Far East, Australia. It also had significant political and geopolitical effects. A lot of policies were put into place by these nations to circumvent future events like this and the impact that these events would have on their economies. So for me, what it did was I internalized the notion that energy was a lot more than what my passion happened to be in the field of energy. It had significant economic, political, and geopolitical implications. Now, within that time frame, in the early 70s, there was another framework beginning to develop. And this had to do with the fact that the use of energy, particularly the use of fossil fuels, which at that time, and for decades later, represented about 85% of total primary energy consumption, there were serious environmental issues associated with using these fossil fuels. And what that did in this country, and similar measures in other developed nations, in this country, we passed the Clean Air Act, the Clean Water Act, we established the Environmental Protection Agency, and that added this environmental dimension to the energy picture. Now, fast forward a couple of decades, go into the 1990s, and there was another issue emerging. And that was the concept of sustainability. And as first introduced, that concept really related to environmental issues. But in the 1990s, people began to think of energy sustainability. Depending as much as we depended on fossil fuels, and with the demand for these fuels continuing to grow as economies continue to develop throughout the world, would there be a point in time when the demand exceeded the production capacity of these fossil fuels, beginning first with petroleum? And so in the early 2000s, it was not uncommon to see books with draconian titles like The End of Oil, Peak Oil. And the concept was this: demand would increase, eventually we'd reach a peak in production capacity, and production would decrease. What would we do then? How would we sustain the world's need for energy resources? And so that stimulated thinking about alternative sources of energy and what we would do to accommodate that gap when it developed, and it would at some point develop because fossil fuels are non-renewable. You use them, they're gone, they're not replenished. Now that thinking changed about 10 years later, maybe sooner than 10 years later. And the new framework was, well, we really are in a situation where we need to realize a peak in demand for these fossil fuels before we reach a peak in production capacity. And that change in perspective was driven by concerns for climate change, global warming and climate change, recognizing that by burning these fossil fuels, we put what we call greenhouse gases into the atmosphere. These greenhouse gases contribute to warming. Warming, in turn, contributes to climate change. So over these years, there's been a change in this perspective. And what we now have is this confluence of energy, politics, geopolitics, economics, and the environment. I submit, and I didn't come to this conclusion easily, that climate change is the defining environmental problem of the 21st century. Energy is about climate change. Climate change is about energy. Now, when we think of climate change as an environmental problem, it's really different from most other kinds of environmental problems that we've had to deal with. And these differences are significant factors. One difference has to do with timescales. Other environmental problems, we sense their implications right away, or within a year, no more than a decade. We sense that they're serious problems within a relatively short time frame, and we begin to deal with them. In the case of climate change, these timescales are larger. the changes occur much more gradually. And we're talking about timescales of decades to, in some aspects of climate change, millennia. All right, so that's a significant difference. Another difference is that when we talk about climate change, we have to, if we're looking at the effects of warming, anthropogenic warming, we have to recognize that there are natural variations. There's natural variability to climate, inducing changes in the climate. So the question is, how do we differentiate between the effects of this anthropogenic influence and natural effects? That is a complicating feature. And then the other issue here is the fact that unlike most environmental problems that are local, perhaps regional, climate change is global. It impacts everyone, and everyone in one way or another contributes to climate change. And if we're to do something about it, global participation, as difficult as that may be, is extremely important. Okay, by way of introduction, I want to make sure that you understand the distinction between global warming, that's the cause, climate change is the effect. Concerning the anthropogenic contribution to global warming, that science is decided. It's irrefutable. And I'm going to go through a very simple example to make that point, and then we can get on to some of the more substantive matters. But consider a winter day. It's cold outside. You're inside in your apartment or in your home. Consider the inside to be a system. And that system can transfer energy in two ways. In one way, there's heat loss to the ambient air, the outside air. So that's an outflow of energy. And if there's nothing to balance that, the temperature in your dwelling is going to decrease. This loss of energy is going to result in a decrease in temperature. To compensate for that, you have a furnace that can supply heat to the interior of the home. So during the day, you have a set point temperature. The temperature in the air in your space drops below that set point. The furnace kicks in, supplies an amount of heat, gets you a little bit above that set point. The furnace goes off, you continue to lose heat to the surroundings. And so throughout the day, that furnace kicks on and off to maintain you relatively close to that set point. Now, if you're like me, in the evening, you like to turn that thermostat down. And at least for a portion, if not all of the evening, you have no energy flowing into your system, but you have energy losses to the colder ambient air. You have energy leaving the system. And so quite naturally, the energy that's stored in your system is decreasing, which is manifested by a decrease in temperature. Now, when morning comes up, you get up, you crank up the thermostat, you're adding more energy from the furnace into the interior space than you're losing. That imbalance eventually brings you back to set point temperature, and you restore this back and forth. All right, so let's expand our thinking and now look at the Earth and its atmosphere as a system. Replace the furnace by the sun, and that becomes your source of energy. Okay, and if that is all there was, there would be no Earth today. The sun would continuously add energy. The Earth would absorb energy from the sun. It would continue to get hotter and hotter. Eventually, it would disintegrate. Well, we have been, for the last 10,000 years, in a state of quasi-equilibrium. And that's because, roughly speaking, the amount of energy that passes through the Earth's atmosphere and stays within the Earth, some of it gets reflected back to space by clouds, by the surface of the Earth, by particulate matter in the atmosphere, but about 70% of it is retained. That is roughly balanced by radiation that's emitted by the Earth and that escapes to outer space. Now, all of the radiation that's emitted does not escape to outer space. Some of it is absorbed by gases, we call them greenhouse gases in the atmosphere, and those that appear naturally are carbon dioxide and water vapor. And it's because of this absorption that we've been able to maintain this equilibrium for about the last 10,000 years. Now, what can disrupt this equilibrium? Well, for one thing, the amount of solar radiation intercepted by the Earth can change. As certain orbital parameters relating to the Earth's orbit around the Sun, as these parameters change slightly, they change the amount of radiation emanating from the Sun, well, not emanating, but incident upon the Earth from the Sun. And it's these changes that can take us in and out of ice ages. Now, I'm going to talk about another time scale here. These changes occur over very large time scales. They're periodic, and they've been going on for the last 2.5 million years, as far as we can tell. They take us into an ice age and out of an ice age. The period over which those changes occur can vary anywhere from 20,000 years to 100,000 years. The last glacial maximum was about 21,000 years ago. The next one is not expected for at least another 20 to 40,000 years. Okay, but that can change, certainly have a big effect on the Earth's climate. Now, we are in an interglacial period where climate is relatively stable. What else can change the climate is something that impedes transfer of this radiation emitted by the Earth's surface to outer space. And what that is an accumulation of more greenhouse gases within the atmosphere, and that began with the onset of the Industrial Revolution and emissions of carbon dioxide and subsequently other greenhouse gases into the atmosphere, trapping some of this radiation, creating an imbalance. More solar radiation penetrating the Earth's atmosphere, being absorbed by the Earth, than radiation leaving the Earth, emitted by the Earth, and passing to outer space. And that has a lot to do with the wavelengths associated with solar radiation. They're relatively small. The wavelengths associated with radiation emitted by the Earth's surface, large. Certain gases, these greenhouse gases, absorb that radiation emitted by the Earth's surface, are relatively transparent to radiation emitted by the Sun. So we have these greenhouse gases, and carbon dioxide is the big one. We burn a fossil fuel, we generate carbon dioxide. Burn a gallon of gasoline, we can all relate to that. How many pounds of carbon dioxide do you think you put into the atmosphere? Gallon of gasoline weighs about 7 pounds. Burn it, and you release carbon dioxide to the atmosphere. How many pounds do you suppose? That's a little high. I'm surprised to keep 19, actually. But more than the weight of the gasoline. And it's because the carbon content of the gasoline combines with oxygen, giving you carbon dioxide, higher molecular weight. And so, gallon of gasoline, 19 pounds of carbon dioxide into the atmosphere. There are other greenhouse gases, but carbon dioxide is the big one, and that's what we're going to focus on. And these are measurements of the amount of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere in parts per million. Pre-industrial revolution, the atmospheric concentration of carbon dioxide kind of hovered between 270 and 280 parts per million for many thousands of years. But since the Industrial Revolution, the amount of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere has been increasing. And that sawtooth pattern that you see there has to do with the fact that during the summer months in the Northern Hemisphere, there's an assimilation of carbon dioxide by plant matter, by trees, forests that are growing. And during the winter months, there is a discharge of carbon dioxide to the atmosphere due to plant decay. But if you forget about that sawtooth pattern, the average concentration of the carbon dioxide in the atmosphere has been increasing. In 2015, the average concentration was about 401 parts per million. Maximum in 2016 was 408 parts per million. Again, pre-industrial, 280 parts per million. So from roughly the late 1700s to 1957, which was when these measurements started. And by the way, they're made in a well-mixed maritime atmosphere at an elevation of about 3,000 meters on the island of Hawaii. So you're getting a good background reading, which is not affected by local sources or sinks of carbon dioxide. But basically, from the late 1700s to 1957, the increase in the concentration was about 35 parts per million, but it's been kind of on steroids ever since. From 1957 through to the present time, we're talking about an increase of more than 90 parts per million over a much shorter time frame. So right now it's increasing at about 2 parts per million. Now, perhaps you're familiar with the Paris Accords. It really was a monumental achievement, the fact that more than 190 nations could finally get together and say, yes, we have to do something about this problem. One of the things that came out of the Paris Accords was an aspirational goal. What measures could we adopt that would prevent the Earth's average temperature from rising more than 2 degrees Celsius above the pre-industrial level? That 2 degrees Celsius being believed to be a point at which the implications of the temperature rise would be onerous and extremely difficult to agree with. And part of keeping it from going above 2 degrees centigrade is keeping CO2 concentrations in the atmosphere below 450 parts per million. Now, when you get to 450 parts per million, and we will get there, you're not going to see 2 degrees C immediately. There's a lag here, a couple of decades. But at an increase of 2 parts per million per year, we could get to 450 parts per million by the year 2040. By 2060, we could very well get to this 2 degrees Celsius limit. And so what's been done before and after the Paris meeting is to look at what are called 2 degree scenarios. What measures can we be putting into place that would prevent us from getting to this point? All right, so who's emitting these greenhouse gases? Here we have the top 4 emitters as of this point in time. And this graph starts in 1960, but if you look at 1960, it makes an important point. Up until that point, emissions were primarily due to the use of fossil energy by industrialized nations. You see the EU and the US up there. You see what today we would call developing nations, namely China and India, much lower than that, and these nations were contributing much less. So as time evolves, what you see is the EU, and they took climate change seriously a lot quicker than many in other regions of the world. You see around 1980, their emissions, CO2 emissions, beginning to decline. That occurred in the US, and you see that happening at around 2007, 2008, initially helped by a serious recession. And you see the effects of recession in this entire pattern, but there's been a decent decline since then. And what's that decline attributable to? It's attributed to increased energy efficiency, substitution of some fossil fuels with other fossil fuels that release less carbon dioxide to the atmosphere, and increased use of carbon-free renewable forms of energy. But what you also see is significant growth. While industrialized nations were leveling off or decreasing, developing nations, driven by Canada, significantly increasing their CO2 emissions, hundreds of millions of people yet to be removed from a state of poverty, industrial development proceeding at an extremely rapid pace, and India following in China's path. All right, so in 2015, total carbon dioxide emissions amounted to about 35 billion tons. Due to the use of fossil fuels, and due to certain industrial processes like producing cement. That's a process that releases CO2 to the atmosphere. If you include the effects of land use changes, net deforestation, development of land for other purposes, then CO2 emissions due to these land use changes go up by about 10%. And then if you include the effects of other greenhouse gases, methane, nitrous oxide, about 200 or 300 man-made chemicals, then it goes from 39 to 51. And the effect of these other greenhouse gases can be measured in carbon dioxide equivalents. How much carbon dioxide would you have to discharge to the atmosphere to have the same effect as these other greenhouse gases? Now, one of the encouraging things is that total emissions of carbon dioxide and equivalent greenhouse gases has been relatively flat for the last 3 years. And that hasn't happened in a long time. And it's been relatively flat as economies have continued to grow. And so this is a ray of hope that there's perhaps a decoupling of emissions from economic growth. And if you look at the United States, between 2008 and 2015, growth in GDP was not spectacular, but it was about 10%, at the same time that carbon dioxide emissions were reduced by almost 10%. That's an encouraging trend. What's in store for us in the future? Most of the folks who project down the road, let's say out to 2040, we'll say that carbon dioxide, this is just a lull, and emissions because of global economic growth, particularly in developing nations, nations yet to achieve developing status, that these emissions will continue to grow for some time to come. We have yet to see if that will happen. Now, before we begin to cast aspersions at China and begin to say, hey, India, control yourself, it's worthwhile to look at carbon dioxide emissions per capita. And that puts a different light on the matter. So this would be carbon dioxide emissions in tons of carbon dioxide per person per year. And in 2015, we were at about 17 tons. You, me, on average, everyone else in the country, we contributed 17 tons of carbon dioxide to the atmosphere. That is more than three times the global average. It's more than twice the average in China, very industrialized economy, and in the European Union. 10 times the average contributed by an Indian, and more than 10 times for many other nations around the world. So there's a disproportionate contribution per capita to these emissions. Right. I give a lot of these lectures, and maybe there are some of you here that there's always more than one or two skeptics and some outright people who deny the existence of global warming. What tangible evidence do we have? Well, one, temperatures are in fact rising. And this is a graphic published in The Economist late summer. And this graph shows what's called a temperature anomaly. And a temperature anomaly is the difference between the temperature today, let's say, and some average. And depending upon who's compiling the data and how it's presented, that baseline can differ. But in this case, it's a deviation from the pre-industrial average. Okay, pre-industrial when we were at 280 parts per million of CO2. And this data is actually put together very carefully. It represents a compilation of results from 30,000 measurement stations around the world. It represents the use of elegant algorithms to statistically analyze this data and come up with a meaningful average. And this is done not just by one organization, it's done by multiple organizations, governmental and non-governmental. And there is a general consensus, there's remarkably good agreement on results obtained by using different procedures for statistical analysis, when to throw something out with justification, when to include it, and how to compute these averages. And so what you see from 1880 through to September of 2016 is, with peaks and valleys, bumps, a steady rise. And oh, by the way, after this 2015 meeting in Paris of the global community, it was decided that two degrees centigrade was too high. The implications were too severe, and that if possible, we should try to limit the temperature rise from pre-industrial levels to 1.5 degrees centigrade. That's not going to happen. We're going to exceed 1.5 degrees centigrade, and we'll probably exceed 2 degrees centigrade. In the 21st century, 15 of the last 16 years were the hottest on record. And it's not happened, as long as these records have been maintained, but for 3 consecutive years, we've had a new record set for the Earth's average temperature. And there are factors that are contributing to this, not the least of which is a huge El Nino phenomenon in 2015 and 2016. But what you're seeing here is a big jump. And next year, no doubt, it'll be followed by a significant drop. So this is where natural variability comes in. And the ENSO phenomenon, I guess I don't need this. ENSO refers to El Niño Southern Oscillation. Periodically, waters in the Pacific Ocean, there'll be an upwelling of these waters that results in the release of a significant amount of energy transfer to the atmosphere, and the temperature of the atmosphere will increase. That's an El Niño. It can be followed by another phenomenon, an El Niña, where it works in reverse. And this occurs all in the Pacific Ocean, a significant amount of energy transfer from the atmosphere back into the ocean. El Niño, you expect to see an increase in the average temperature of the Earth's surface. La Niña, a decrease in the Earth's average temperature. So what the red bars show is El Niño years. What the blue bars show is La Niña years. And you see this natural variability, but on top of this natural variability, you have a gradual increase in temperatures. And in 2015-2016, that El Niño brought us to a temperature anomaly of 0.9 degrees centigrade. So as I said before, that's one of the things that kind of complicates matters in terms of attribution of increases in temperature to global warming. El Niño is not the only phenomenon. There are things, oceanic circulation patterns are huge, and they represent a tremendous transfer of energy around the world. There are patterns that involve energy transfer from surface waters at depths up to 2,000 meters with deeper waters. And these have cyclic patterns that can affect the Earth's average surface temperature. So if you leave this lecture with nothing else, what I'd like you to do is to kind of step back from what happens year by year and really look at this problem in a longer reference frame. Think in terms of a decadal average, an average over 10 years, and because that'll wipe out some of these, not all of them, but some of these natural variations. So if you look at a decadal average, you'll see that the 1980s were the warmest decade on record at all time, exceeded by the 1990s, exceeded by the 2000s, and to be exceeded by the 2010 through 2019. If you average the data through 2016, that anomaly goes from an average of 50.51 degrees Celsius in the 1990s to 0.73 degrees Celsius in the 2000 to 2019 timeframe. Now, that may come down a little bit because I'm expecting some cooling to occur over the next few years. Now, that may not seem like a lot to you, and it isn't, but going from a glacial maximum to an interglacial period results in a change in the Earth's average surface temperature of 4 to 5 degrees Celsius. Now, that's a big change in the climate of the Earth. You're in the middle of an ice age, and then you go to this interglacial period, and the average temperature is only changed by 4 to 5 degrees C. So if we're talking about 0.73 degrees C, and that average is relative to I think, to the average surface temperature from 1900 through 1999, does not include earlier increases in temperature. We're beginning to talk about things that are significant. 2 degrees Celsius relative to this 4 or 5 degree temperature change taking us from an ice age to an interglacial is significant. All right, so the Earth's Earth's average surface temperature is increasing, and there is a significant human fingerprint. One of the things that's interesting is, well, if temperatures are increasing in the lower atmosphere, maybe intuitively you would expect them to increase throughout the atmosphere. But they're not. They're actually decreasing in upper levels of the Earth's atmosphere. But that's really exactly what you would expect. As more radiation is absorbed by increased greenhouse gas concentrations in the lower atmosphere, there's less radiation available for absorption in the other atmosphere. So this observable is consistent with what one would expect due to anthropogenic global warming. This is probably the best visible evidence of the fact that the Earth is warming. And there's a graphic here that does that very nicely. Arctic sea ice is just seawater that is frozen. There are two forms of this sea ice. There is perennial, long-established thick ice. And there is much thinner seasonal ice. So as you go from the winter months, where you have a maximum, if you will, in portions of the Arctic Ocean covered by sea ice, to the late summer months, when warming has reduced the extent of coverage, you're seeing the effects of a natural order of things. What we've shown here is this September minimum. All of the melting that has occurred during the spring and summer months has occurred. It's time to begin a cooling process where ice is formed. Right, so this is the September minimum. And what you see here is the minimum in 2011. And what you see is the median value of that minimum over the time frame from 1979 to 2000. And so what you're looking at is a large reduction in sea ice coverage. And that large reduction in sea ice coverage is due to global warming. Increasing greenhouse gas concentrations in the atmosphere contribute to warming. Warming has associated feedback effects. And you're seeing one of these feedback effects here. If you decrease the amount of ice coverage, not only in the Arctic, anywhere else, you're decreasing the extent to which solar radiation incident on the surface is reflected back to space. Water will absorb virtually all of that solar radiation. Ice will reflect most of that radiation. So as you reduce the amount of Arctic sea cover, you're increasing the amount to which solar radiation is absorbed. You're increasing the heating effect. That's a positive feedback mechanism. and it's contributing to what's called Arctic amplification. The average surface temperature in regions of the Arctic has been increasing at twice the rate of the global average, twice the rate. And this is one contributing factor. Now, as the temperature in the Arctic increases more rapidly than, let's say, the temperature in other latitudes of the northern hemisphere, that reduces the temperature difference between the atmosphere in these latitudes, other latitudes of the northern hemisphere, and the temperature in the Arctic region. And that temperature difference is a major determining factor in climate. You reduce that temperature difference, and it's going to affect atmospheric circulation patterns, which affect climate. So that's a significant observable. We're losing ice, land-based ice, throughout the world. I think we're all familiar with loss of ice from glaciers in Alaska, Kilimanjaro, other regions of the world. Some of this ice makes its way to the sea, contributing to increases in sea level. The big areas of concern are the ice sheet in Greenland, and even a bigger concern, the ice sheet in Antarctica. Between the last ice age and this interglacial period, sea levels rose by 130 meters. The Greenland ice sheet has the capacity to increase sea levels by another 7 meters. The Antarctic ice sheet has the capacity to increase sea levels by another 58 meters. We're already seeing significant ice loss from the Greenland ice sheet, principally due to surface melting, and we're beginning to see the effects of potential ice loss from Antarctic. And this contributes to rising sea levels. And when I talked about timescales earlier, and I said that, hey, the effects of global warming are occurring on much longer timescales, this is probably a good example. This gives you the change in the global mean sea level in millimeters from 1980 through, where are we? I think this is through 2012. And the hazy areas are uncertainty bands in the way these measurements were originally made using tide gauges. Things became a lot more accurate when the measurements were made via satellite. So what you see is a gradual increase. But the total increase from 1880 to 2015 is only 235 millimeters, about a foot. And it's pretty easy to become complacent about that. But one thing that you might notice is that the rate at which the sea level is increasing, that rate is increasing. Averaged over the 20th century, about 1.7 millimeters per year. Averaged over roughly the last 20 years, 3.2 millimeters per year. In 2015, it was about 3.5 millimeters per year. So there seems to be some nonlinear behavior here with the rate increasing. So what can we expect for 2100? In the introduction, it was mentioned that we aren't going to be around in the year 2100, and there's not much we can do, I guess, to influence conditions in 2100. Maybe that was the thrust, but I think there are things that we can do. What would be sea level in 2100? The Intergovernmental Program on Climate Change, in their fifth assessment report, they call it as it is. There's a lot of uncertainty. They think it could be an additional 250 millimeters to 800 millimeters. A lot of uncertainty in their prediction. And they assume that there was no contribution due to changes in the Antarctic ice sheet and contributions due to changes in the Greenland ice sheet would only be due to surface melting. And that was what they came up with. 800 millimeters, that would be significant, because there are several hundred million people around the world living at sea level below 1 meter. And they would be seriously impacted. So if we have a responsibility, and I'm dealing with a little bit of ethics here, if we have a responsibility to future generations, generational ethics, maybe we ought to give some thought to this. You know, what kind of difficulties are we going to create for people who live very close to sea level? Well, I mentioned nonlinear behavior. What if the rate at which sea levels increase, that rate itself increases at 2.3% a year? That would be a doubling every 30 years. That would take that would give us an increase of 900 millimeters by 2100. And that would put us over that 1 meter mark if you add the pre-existing increase. 3.5% per year, doubling every 20 years, it would be an increase of 1.8 meters. That's a large increase. Now, what is it that might contribute to this nonlinear behavior? In the Greenland ice sheet and in the ice sheet on Antarctica, there are what are called marine terminating glaciers. These are glaciers that have outlets to the sea, outlets to the ocean. And these marine terminating glaciers at their leading edge have what are called ice shelves. And these ice shelves float on the ocean. These ice shelves can be hundreds of meters thick. They can be hundreds of kilometers long. I mean, they're really big things. And one of the effects that they have is to buttress the ice sheets, to slow down motion of the ice sheets, or the glaciers, I should say, to the oceans. Glaciers are not static things. They're always in motion. Now, if you have some equilibrium in terms of preserving the amount of water stored in ice, then accumulation of ice on the glaciers due to snowfall is balanced by breakup of these ice shelves at their leading edge. And that's been going on for thousands of years. One of the things that's happening now is that you have warmer circumpolar water circulation beginning to melt the underlayer of these ice sheets and beginning to lead in premature breakup of these ice shelves. And with premature breakup of the ice shelves, a reduction in the resistance that these ice shelves provide to movement of the glaciers. So we're seeing glaciers accelerate, not only in Greenland, but also in Antarctica. In some cases, the grounding line for these ice shelves have reached the bedrock of these glaciers. And what we're finding, not me, but geologists who do this thing, is that these warmer waters are beginning to eat into the under part of the glacier between the bedrock and the glacier, and that many of these glaciers have reversed sloping bedrocks. They can go down for hundreds of meters, thousands of meters into the bedrock, and that this warm water is beginning to erode these glaciers within the bedrock. And eventually erosion will cause fractures of portions of the glaciers, and anything that breaks off ends up in the sea, it melts and contributes to global warming. So this just gives you a snapshot of what's happening in Antarctica, and start with the Larsen ice shelves. I don't know if you saw recently some beautiful photographs of what looks like incipient breakup. There are three Larsen ice shelves. Larsen A started to disintegrate in the early 80s. It's gone. And sea waters are beginning to erode the glacier that backed up to that ice shelf. In terms of Larsen B, the second of these ice shelves, breakup started in early 2000s. That ice shelf is expected to be gone completely by 2020. And what was publicized recently, I think it was last week, is a major rift in the Larsen C ice shelf, the first sign that it may break up. a rift that is an interstate highway wide. It's hundreds of meters deep, and it goes for 75 miles out of a total of 90 miles associated with the width of this ice shelf. That ice shelf has an area, or beyond that rift, an area the size of Delaware. It's going to break off pretty soon, go into the ocean, and eventually melt. So what is happening has the potential to significantly increase sea levels. All right, so summarize, what are the consequences of global warming and climate change? We talked about loss of Arctic ice, feedback effects, rising sea levels. Well, what can rising sea levels do? Certainly damage to infrastructure, roads, railways, airports, pipelines, and so on. A very comprehensive study was looked at the effect of rising sea level along the Gulf Coast from Houston through New Orleans and Mississippi, where there's a tremendous concentration of infrastructure at low-lying levels, particularly infrastructure that is vital to supplying fossil fuels, oil and natural gas, throughout to the rest of the U.S., and identify the vulnerability of that infrastructure to rising sea levels. And of course, as you submerge your coastal regions, you get salinization of freshwater supplies, you diminish the availability of freshwater supplies, and you contribute to salinating floodplains and deltas. Loss of agricultural production will be part of this, and relocation of large populations. Eventually that will happen. And I think we have an understanding of the implications of large amounts of refugees by looking at what's happened in Europe today and what's happening in our southern borders with people from Central America trying to escape the difficult conditions that oppress them at this moment. Millions of people leaving because agricultural production can no longer support them. There are no longer sufficient supplies of potable water. That creates significant social problems. Increased frequency and intensity of extreme weather events. Now, until recently, I don't think there was any reputable spokesperson on climate change who would say a particular extreme weather event was due to global warming. There's just too much natural variability in the system. But within the last 5 years, there's been a credible science evolving that is used to establish the probability that a particular event, like the boreal forest fires that we saw in Canada, very rare event, or like the flooding that occurred in Louisiana about a year ago, torrential rains, that can statistically analyze past events, couple that analysis with climate models, and attach a probability to 80% probability that this event was significantly influenced by anthropogenic climate change. And these things are occurring, we're aware of them, and they are occurring more frequently. Climate change has an effect on natural ecosystems. Right now, loss of species around the world is occurring at a rate that's about 3 orders of magnitude larger than the background rate. And the background rate would have been the rate that existed before the Industrial Revolution. And certainly there are many things that contribute to loss of species, but climate change and an aspect of increasing carbon dioxide concentrations in the atmosphere is increased acidification of ocean waters, and that has serious ecological consequences. About 80% of the world's species reside in the world's oceans. And then destabilization of governments and increased conflicts. In the last two quadrennial reports of the U.S. Department of Defense, this issue was indicated as a significant global threat. All right, so there you have it. I came to this issue through a back door. My interests have always been in energy. And I teach a course on energy technology and policy. And in developing background material for this policy, this course. I would look at renewables, I'd look at coal, I'd look at gas, I'd look at how we generate electricity, I'd look at how we handle transportation. Over a period of about 5 or 6 years, it was becoming obvious to me that this thing called global warming and climate change was something that merited serious attention. So that's the back door through which I approached this issue. And I needed to be convinced that it was a significant issue and that it should be a primary basis for projecting our future course of energy use, energy development. I am convinced. All right, so I'm an engineer. And a couple of years ago, I was putting together in my mind an analogy. What would be an appropriate response to global warming and climate change? And as an engineer, over the years, I've, through various experiences, been conditioned to look at things that could threaten complex engineered systems. A nuclear power plant, the internet, the grid, something I'm more familiar with, a space shuttle. And, you know, in designing these things and operating them, you try to be extremely conservative. And one of the things you try to condition yourself to do is to look at signals, things that might indicate a high potential for future failure. And you try to respond to these signals. And so failure of these systems, Columbia and Challenger space shuttles, Fukushima Daiichi, the electric grid goes down big time on occasion. These things are typically preceded by weak signals. And one of the things that we're learning is that weak signals should not be accompanied by weak responses. They need to be accompanied by strong responses to avert these catastrophic effects. So how do we respond to these signals of global warming and climate change that I've taken you through? They are signals. Maybe 10, 20 years ago, they were weak signals. They're not weak signals anymore. They're strong, and they're getting stronger. We need to respond aggressively. There are three options that people consider when they look at climate change. One is mitigation. And mitigation addresses root cause. And what that says is, let's look at what's causing this, and let's remediate it, let's deal with it, let's eliminate the cause. And that gets to greenhouse gas emissions. Let's bring these emissions down, let's reduce the threat. The other thing is adaptation, and you can look at adaptation in two different ways. My friends in the fossil fuel industry who accept global warming and its effect on climate change, a number of them look at adaptation in the following way. Look, we're going to continue to burn fossil fuels, but we need to create resiliency. We need to build resiliency into our infrastructure. We need to come up with ways to deal with the propagation of vector diseases that might come with global warming. We need to develop strains, agricultural strains that are drought resistant, that are salt resistant. They would focus on adaptation. Another way of looking at adaptation is saying, I would like to minimize the extent to which we have to implement adaptation. And the way that I can do that is that I can emphasize mitigation. I can invest a lot of resources into mitigation. Now, I'll tell you right now, adaptation is going to be necessary. And right now, both of these things are important. And there are cities around the world that are very seriously looking at adaptation measures that they can begin taking now. Intervention is the measure of last resort. Look, whatever you might have done in mitigation, it's not working. Things are proceeding at a very rapid pace. There's serious threat to the Earth environmental system, to the global economy. adaptation isn't sufficient, then let's intervene. Let's see if we can manage global warming by altering solar radiation, by removing carbon dioxide from the atmosphere. I'm not opposed to doing research in this area, but I think if we have to use these methods 50 years from now, 100 years from now, we, as today's representatives of the human species, will have abdicated our responsibility to future generations. All right, I'm going to move along. By the way, you can get these slides. The organizers of these series have an electronic version that they'd be happy to share with you. You can email me and I'll share it with you. Mitigation is what I'm going to emphasize. There are three boxes here, three ways that you could approach this. All of them have some merit. One way is to improve the efficiency with which we produce energy, we convert energy from one form to another, and the efficiency with which we use energy. One is a supply side consideration, the other is a demand side consideration. McKinsey did a very comprehensive study about 6 years ago. It concluded that efficiency was a win-win proposition, that you can reduce emissions at low cost, and these costs have a positive payback over a reasonable period of time, 2 to 5 years, let's say. So it's win-win economically, win-win from the standpoint of the environment. The other side of this is energy conservation. Energy efficiency is doing the same or even more with less, using less energy to do what you want to do. Conservation is simply doing less. Asking yourself is, you know, what kind of pleasure, what kind of value do I really get from this expenditure of energy? Is it really necessary if I can still lead a life that has an acceptable standard of living, gives me considerable pleasure and happiness without consuming energy in this fashion? Shouldn't I do so? Right, the other bar has to do with decarbonization of energy utilization, converting from one fuel that has a large carbon to hydrogen ratio to a fuel that has a lower carbon to hydrogen ratio, going non-carbon with nuclear. I'm an advocate of nuclear power. Unfortunately, it's become extremely expensive. And then increasingly using renewables. Wind, solar, and biofuels are the things that I target as being extremely important. I think geothermal, wave, and tidal energy have a role to play, but it's a much smaller role. The transportation sector is ripe for changes that would contribute to reducing greenhouse gas emission. And then there's the option of capturing carbon dioxide, either from the atmosphere by growing more trees, that would be indirect, or by capturing it before it's discharged to the atmosphere, let's say from a power plant, coal-fired power plant, capturing it, compressing it, and pumping it underground. We're struggling with both of those areas. They're not delivering what we hoped they would deliver. Now, to get to the end of this and leave a little bit of time for questions, I'm bullish on solar. And this first slide gives you the growth trajectory for solar energy. This is utility scale solar energy, increasing very rapidly, 40% average annual growth since 2005, 65% cost reductions in implementing utility scale solar power between 2008 and 2015. 2016, the world added another 73 gigawatts. This development has to be continued and continued aggressively. In terms of who's leading here, you're going to see in solar, as well as in wind, which will follow, China is driving the global market. In solar, we've been late to the game, but we're coming on strong. Germany was early to the game. It's fading. If you look at the numbers after 2016, I wouldn't be surprised if we're in second place because of the capacity that we added in 2016. This is generating capacity. And wind, the same thing. There's been an increase, slower growth trajectory, 20% on average annual growth to 433 gigawatts here. Just to put this in perspective, the generating capacity, total generating capacity in the United States is about 1,000 gigawatts. So right now with solar and wind globally, we have the same generating capacity that the US has from all energy sources. And again, China looms very strong. China has committed $360 billion to enhance development of wind and solar energy over the next 4 years through 2020. They're going into this big time. They want to be the world's largest supplier of solar panels, and if they could pull it off, the largest supplier of turbines and related components. All right, so in looking at the future, investing in the future, I think we have to double down, triple down on solar and wind energy. But there are some limiting factors. In order to maximize the extent to which we can use solar and wind, we need to do two things, not only in this country, but in other countries as well. And they have to do with the grid, and they have to do with energy storage. Energy storage because solar and wind are intermittent forms of energy. So here are just a few items related to the grid. It needs to be larger. We need to have a grid that allows us to transport wind generated electricity from regions of high productivity that happen to be sparsely populated to regions that are heavily populated. So take wind generated in North Dakota, South Dakota, Oklahoma, Kansas, have a grid that can get that wind to Chicago and other large urban areas. And then have a grid that is structured in a fashion that reduces this intermittent effect. The grid has to be smarter. There has to be more integration with distributed power, utility scale power, demand response, things of that nature. These represent huge investment opportunities down the road. There's a lot of innovation going on in this area. There's a lot of capital being put into related technologies in this area. There's a lot more that can be done. And the grid has to be tougher, has to be resilient to extreme weather events and to cyber attacks. And then energy storage, particularly battery storage, there's a lot more that we have to do there. God bless Elon Musk for what he's trying to do. But lithium-ion batteries can take us only so far. There are improvements yet to be made. We need to look at next-generation batteries, batteries that give us improved performance and get them to market quicker. So path forward, where do we invest? Here are where I think the best investment opportunities are. Energy efficiency, all kinds of things that can be done to improve energy efficiency that have economic value, that bring a good return to investors, and so on down the line. Electric vehicles, I'll say a bit about that. In 2015, there were 1 million electric vehicles on the market. That's all electric and plug-in electric. My prediction 10 years hence is that there will be 50 million vehicles on the market. 50 million out of 1.3 billion vehicles, that's still only 4%. Nice growth. But this 2DS scenario that I talked about, what they would like to see in one of the scenarios is 700 to 800 million electric vehicles on the market by 2040, with virtually all of the electricity generated for those vehicles from carbon-free sources of energy. That will be quite a trip if we get there. And then there's a lot of things that we can do with respect to cities. 25% of the world's population lived in cities, and 1950. We passed the 50% mark in something like 2007. By 2050, two-thirds of the world's population will live in cities. Right now, urban areas account for about 80% of global energy consumption. There are a lot of things we can do within cities to consume energy more effectively, more efficiently, reduce consumption. All right, carrots and sticks. Policy is important here, and it's interesting that I should mention that on the day of an inauguration of a new administration. Policy is extremely important. Last September, in the New York Times, Henry Paulson, former Secretary of Treasury, published an op-ed in which he talked about a very comprehensive study that had recently been published. It said that we can achieve this 2-degree centigrade scenario, but it's going to require a significant investment of capital. And they ran through the numbers, of course, with approximations, and they concluded that it would require $90 trillion over 15 years. Trillion, average of $6 trillion per year in a global economy that maybe global world product is about $75 trillion per year. And he felt it was doable. He felt if the world's nations, if nations, if states within nations, if communities within states got behind this, there are trillions of dollars that are kind of sitting unused in global corporations. If NGOs, if everybody got behind this, that this could be done. So, what are some of the things that government can do? You can use monetary and fiscal policy to stimulate investments in clean energy technologies, tax-free green bonds, production and investment tax credits. We've seen a nice growth in this country over a period of time in solar and wind, and particularly the last year, and it's going to carry over for another year or two, in wind and solar. Wind because of a production tax credit, solar because of an investment tax credit. Those things are going to wind down and expire almost completely by 2021. I think it's important that these tax credits get renewed. It's important that our government contributes to accelerating the growth of these clean energies through incentives. And of course, the government has to continue to be a player in research and development. Regulations, I think they matter here. Efficiency standards, let's set the bar and let's set it at a reasonable height and the system will respond. Fuel economy standards, going to be interesting to see how that one goes. Renewable portfolio standards, they're established by the states. Virtually every economist says that the way to deal with this is to put a tax on carbon, and I happen to agree. I'd like to see that happen. Prospects for it happening in this country are probably very slim. In eliminating fossil fuel subsidies, we'll see how that goes. All right. One final statement. In the Western world, particularly in countries like the US, we have huge consumption appetites. I think it could be said, without prejudice, that we overconsume. What I would like to see, I don't think technology and capital investment can do it all to keep us within this 2-degree scenario. We're going to exceed it. By how much we exceed it will depend upon how hard we work to avoid it. What I've talked about is technology. I've talked a little bit about capital investment. You pull that together, and I really don't think we're going to be able to do it all. What I think is going to be needed is an adjustment in cultural norms, not just technology and investment, but a change in human behavior. I think those of us in Western nations, highly developed nations, need to moderate our consumption. And those in developing nations need to moderate their expectations. getting back to my days as an undergraduate, I guess Pogo was the equivalent of Dilbert today. And on the first Earth Day in 1970, he put out a poster that said, "We have met the enemy, and it is us. And this is just simply accentuating what I just said, that we all have a role to play in this. I think we need to look at our lifestyles. We need to look at what really makes us happy, satisfied, and see if there's a possibility to reduce our levels of energy consumption. And hopefully, if that becomes to spread, I think conservation has to become a social imperative, okay, a social norm, and not just in this country, but throughout the world. So with that, I thank you for your attention, and I'm sorry for running over. I guess there's simply too much to talk about. I know many of you have to leave, but I'll stay as long as you want me to stay, and I'd be happy to address any questions or take any comments that you might want to make. There's one there.
Thank you. Given your final statement about the importance of social acceptance of the situation in order to modify behavior, are there non-academic works that people in general would read that you would recommend to help that along?
I'm sure there are, but to be honest with you, with all the reading I've done, I've not looked extensively at these, but I have thought a bit about marketing, if you will. I think a lot more can be done to educate the public, not only in this country, but across the world, through media, through effective materials that really grab people's attention on how serious this problem is. And certainly it can be done through television. And we haven't done this. We haven't done it to any degree, and if we've done it, we haven't done it well. There are people who know a lot about marketing. And you know, a lot of the money that organizations like the Environmental Defense Fund devote to protecting the environment, I think taking a portion of that money and putting it into marketing campaigns that get this message out to people effectively in ways that they can really internalize and really feel, I think we could do a lot more with that. Up on the right, oops.
So one thing I always hear is that electric cars are going to be powered by non-renewable energy sources anyway, and not clean burning coal and all these things. What's kind of your response to that? Because it's kind of a response I hear all the time to why electric cars aren't really, like, they're kind of pointless anyway.
Yeah, there are some life cycle studies that have been done on electric cars, particularly studies that are used, that look at the materials used to produce the batteries that are used in these vehicles and the energy consumption associated with producing the batteries, that put into question whether there will in fact be a reduction in the amount of greenhouse gas emissions associated with these vehicles. But economies are going to become increasingly more electrified down the road. And the issue will be more, how is that electricity generated? If you believe that increasingly more of that electricity will be generated by solar and wind, and there's an issue with solar in terms of photovoltaic materials, and the materials, what it takes to produce these materials and where they're resourced and how they influence the life cycle energy considerations. But if some of these materials issues can be worked out, then I don't think there'll be any question whatsoever that, and it applies also to wind energy too, there are materials used in the generators in a wind turbine. I think the net effect is still positive today, that you definitely reduce greenhouse gas emissions, but there are ways to make that reduction even more significant from the standpoint of life cycle costs. The battery part of electric vehicles is extremely important. There was a question.
Thank you. Could you speak a little bit about the prospects and challenges for nuclear power, both here in America and abroad? I know nations like China and India are investing more heavily, so I'd like to hear what you have to say about that.
What was the first part of the question? Something power?
Some prospects and challenges for nuclear power.
Prospects of distributed power? Oh, nuclear power. Yes. China is investing very heavily in nuclear power, and India is in the process of doing likewise. Nuclear power provides us with what's called baseload power. It's available at any time. These things operate 24/7, 52 weeks a year until you take them down to refuel. They are, in fact, very reliable. In contrast to non-renewable sources of energy. I, for one, believe that we're going to need substantial baseload power in this country and in most other developed countries for years to come. So China has made a commitment to developing a nuclear energy base. And I'm assuming they can do it effectively. The big issue there is how you manage radioactive waste materials. Do you manage them effectively? Prevent those waste from leaking into the environment, and also critically preventing the waste from leaking into the hands of potential terrorists. India is going to do the same thing. In this country, we have 4 nuclear power plants under construction. The problem in this country, and it's a problem globally, and it may slow China down and India down, these things, based upon third generation technologies that we have today, are very, very expensive to build. There are 2 under construction in Europe now that are years behind schedule and billions of dollars over budget. The 4 under construction in this country are behind schedule and are also billions over budget. So you look at the investment community and they're saying that even with some incentives provided by government during the Bush administration, they're kind of reluctant to commit capital in this area, unless there's a public utility commission or commissions in the states that would approve the project and commit to certain purchase power agreements that allow the utilities and their investors to make money. And that's the case with the 4 under construction. States of Georgia and South Carolina have made these commitments. Now, one other comment. What's happening in this country is a decommissioning of existing power plants. We had 103 of these about 5 years ago. I think we're down to 96 or so. Nuclear power plants are being decommissioned, not because they're not functioning reliably or they're unsafe, but because they're not economically competitive with natural gas or today with wind and tomorrow with solar. I think it's a mistake to decommission these nuclear power plants. I think they provide a good, reliable source of carbon-free energy, and I, for one, would be in favor of providing some incentives for continuing their operation. Now, some of you may disagree with me with very good reasons for disagreeing with me, but providing things like a production tax credit to these utilities, whoever is operating these power plants, to keep them running. I saw something cross my desk a couple of days ago. California, Right now, 33% of its electricity is generated by renewables. They've decommissioned three nuclear power plants. Had they kept those power plants in operation, almost two-thirds of the electricity generated in California today would be generated by carbon-free sources of energy. So it does make a difference. We okay?
Frank, thank you ever so much. On behalf of the students and faculty,
all right, thank you. All right, thank you.